Thankful for this church. I'm thankful that when I came here for the Christmas play, spelt the spirit of conviction on me over there, and I fought it for two nights, sitting there crying, watching you guys put on a wonderful play. I felt the spirit of conviction when I come watch Harley get baptized, and I fought it, and I fought it, and I fought it. And then, you know, everyone complains about COVID, but I'm thankful for it because it gave me the time at home to find my Bible again. So I'm thankful for that, and Harley kind of put me in the, I don't know, threw me under the bus, whatever. I really, I'm going to sing tonight, and I'm trying to remember because I feel like a new Christian. So I'm trying to remember how to pray and how to worship, and I hope you guys like this, but I hope it pleases God more than that. So that's just where I'm at with it. I ain't promising nothing. It's just been on my heart. When I was 18 years old, I went and right with the Lord, and I was trying to learn to sing, and I worked down at Taylor Lumber with my dad. And this song, I heard it on a bluegrass record that I had, and it just has always stuck with me. And then later, you know, I thought, man, like I didn't even realize what I was singing back then, you know, but it's probably not going to be very good, but I'm trying to praise the Lord tonight. So Someday when my last line is written, someday when I've drawn my last breath, when my last words on earth have been spoken, and my lips are sealed in death, don't look on my cold form in pity. Don't think of me as one dead. It'll just be the house I once lived in. My spirit by then will have fled. I'll have finished my time here allotted, but I won't be in darkness alone. I will have heard from heaven the summons to come on home. And when my body is in the grave, don't think that I'll be there. I won't be dead, but living in the place Jesus went to prepare. And after all is said and done, know that my last earnest prayer is that my loved ones be ready someday to meet me there. Now we'll sing something that ain't so slow. How's that sound? Everybody knows this song, I'm sure. B. Well, glory, 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 somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody. Glory, glory, somebody touch me. Must be in the hands of Lord. While I was praying,
has a sense of humor, because I was praying on the way down. I said, Lord, if you want me to sing, show me tonight. So I'm sitting there and all this stuff's coming up on the screen, sis. It says Harley and Julie Horsley singing. There's my sign. I mean, literally. You pray for me, brother. I get nervous too. Wherever he went there, done a good job. I said, obviously he hadn't heard me sing yet, or he wouldn't be worried about it. He's done a fine job.
Hear me
You're making the sun to shine, putting the stars up in the sky, for the flowers that bloom, the ocean so blue. Thank you, Lord, for every sparrow that sings and makes sweet melody, for the rivers that flow, the rain. Saving my soul. Spirit, I feel it's your presence so real. I'm gonna thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just have to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. I thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. Just have to thank you, Lord, for saving my soul, making me whole. I thank you, Lord. For being my friend, so dear, giving my sad heart cheer, for holding my hand when I could not stand. Thank you, Lord, for giving your life for me on that cross at Calvary, for taking my place, sweet mercy and grace. I thank you, Lord. I just want to thank. Saving my soul, making me whole. I thank you, Lord, for my whole family and the joy my children bring, for shoes on our feet, plenty to eat. I thank you, Lord, and for the church where I can worship and pray, the freedom that I have today. For your spirit I feel, your presence so real. I thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. I thank you, Lord. I just want. Just have to thank you, Lord, for saving my soul and making me whole. I thank you, Lord, for saving my soul, making me whole. I thank you, Lord. Ooh, Lord. Praise the Lord. For being my friend, so dear, giving my sad heart cheer, for holding my hand when I could not stand. Thank you, Lord, for giving your life for me on that cross at Calvary, for taking my place. Sweet mercy and grace, I thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. I thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just have to thank saving my soul, making me whole. I thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. I thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. To be, and we could go home tonight and say we've been in the presence of the Lord, and but then I'd go home whooped because I still got a little something the Lord wants me to share, and it doesn't seem to fit this service at all, but then I am a little strange, so that's all right. That's how God uses me. Turn your Bibles tonight to 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. Those that would like to could stand for the reading of God's Word. I'm not going to read much. 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. Starting at the fourth verse. Pray for me. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administration, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but is the same God, which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. Going to take our text tonight from verse 6. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. And may God's blessing be on the reading of His Word. You can be seated. Father, we thank you, Lord, for letting us be in your house tonight, God, and for your presence, Lord. We thank you for all the songs and the testimonies and, Lord, how your glory rains down, and we feel so undeserving, and we are undeserving, Lord, and we thank you for the blood that's kept us clean. We thank you, Lord, for your sweet mercy, Lord. We pray that you'd have your way tonight. Move me out of the way, Lord God, and just have your say tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. I was praying about the message, and Sister Lola, I never know what God wants until God tells me. That's just the way that it is. I just don't know. And he gives you messages in different ways, and sometimes it's in a dream, sometimes it's in just a word that you've heard, or he just drops something down your spirit when you're driving or something. And Saturday, and I've got to tell how this came to be so that I can get on into it, but Saturday, my husband and I had plans to go out to dinner. which I like that. I mean, you know, it's just like it was his idea. That's even better. You know, he's just like, we'll go out to Bob Evans tonight. I said, that sounds really good. And I mean, I could just picture, I mean, some of y'all might be on them diets, but I could just picture them big hot rolls and that butter, you know, that they bring to the table. And I was just like, I'm in. So anyway, Sister Linda, he said we'd go out to dinner. And I looked forward to that part of the day. But around 10 or 11 o'clock in the day, the Lord began to speak to me, and there was a revival going on at Pertee Church. And the Lord said to me, I want you to go to that revival tonight. I was like, well, we didn't even have the whole conversation. I didn't get to mention Bob Evans to God because he does not care about that. I want you to know that. I mean, he blesses us, but we don't belong to ourselves. So he said, I want you to go to the revival at Pertee tonight. So I get there, and we're a little bit early, and one of our ladies that goes down to the church, she pulled out of her car, and she said, she rolled out of there, and she said, oh, I prayed all day that you would come. I said, so it's you, huh? And then I teased her because God heard her prayer. God has a way of getting you where you need to be, and doing what he wants to do if we will listen. So when we got there to the service, I'm sitting there and I'm knowing I'm there for a reason. I'm wondering what the reason is, because I mean, I'll just be honest with you. When you go visit other churches, sometimes if you got a reputation of being a little bit rowdy or something, you know, they just like, watch that one. She's trouble. I don't know if y'all get that or not, but I get that a lot. I'm used to it. I mean, I go to a lot of places where, like, step back. She's here. Something's going to happen. And I don't mean that in any proud way, and I don't mean it in any mean way. It's just the truth. If God's people would just let God's people be God's people, we'd have less trouble. He made us all different. He expects us to be different, and that's just how he made us. So anyway, I didn't do anything out of hand. You know, I was asked to sing a song. I sung a song. But as I was sitting there and listening to the minister preach, God spoke to me this. And he reminded me that a few years ago, maybe several years ago, I turned 60 this year, all my years blend together just like all the days of the week. And I don't know what day of the week it is until somebody tells me. That's just the way it goes anymore. But it could have been several years ago. I remember I preached along these lines at Union Hill. And God spoke to me and he said, I want you to preach about the operator's license. In verse 6, there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. God told me over there that night that he wanted his church to get their operator's license. For you young folks, that means your driver's license. But for us old folks, we know what an operator's license is. And Brother Tommy, there's some effort that goes into getting that license to be able to be a licensed driver. And I remember when we were young, back in the day, you know, they had driver's ed school. They still have driver's ed, right? But you got to pay for it, like a lot of money. But anyway, back in the day, they used to have a driver's ed class. We had a driver's ed teacher. We had to attend that class, and I remember going there because, you know, I'm old, and they offered it right in school. Believe it or not, kids, we used to have driver's ed right at school, right in class. And we had a certain teacher for that. But, you know, I just thought it was like a free class. Hey, whatever, you know. I know you thought I'd take it serious. I didn't take it serious. I was like, oh, they're going to teach us how to drive. Well, isn't that special? Everybody's driving anyway, you know. We're all going to drive. It's going to be all right. I don't need to learn anything from this class, and this teacher is annoying. And he was. But we'll leave that for another message. But anyway, I'm sitting in that class, and he's just going on and on. Do you remember? Wasn't it annoying? Come on, Pastor, back me up. I put him on the spot. He's a good feller. He was a nice enough guy, but that class was so boring. I mean, I'm just sitting there thinking, man, I wish I had a Pepsi. And he's just talking and talking, and it's just like, and then they show you all these pictures of these signs you're supposed to recognize, and you get out on the road, and none of those signs look like what they did in that class anyhow. I don't understand that. But anyway, it was like that. And so I didn't take it serious. I just thought it was boring. I'm just like, if you ever get done with the talking so I can get to the driving, maybe there'll be some fun in this thing. And right now, I'm just bored to death. So they bring in the simulator. Do you remember the simulator? Or did you get to do that? Oh, wow, you missed out. I'm older than him. So they bring in this big semi-like trailer. And on the inside is, you do remember, they had the video, and you got to sit in this little chair at your pretend car. And I'm going somewhere with this, I promise. At least I think so. And you get to sit in that seat, and that's your little pretend car, sissy. And you get to look at the screen, and you're supposed to cut the wheel, and you're supposed to put on the brakes. And you got all these lights light up if you're doing it right. Well, I started off doing it right. And then I got bored. So I kept flooring it, you know. I mean, it had a gas pedal, and, you know, and every time I saw somebody in the road that I just, I mean, I wasn't saved, and it was virtual, but anyway, I just seen how many pedestrians I could hit, you know. I don't recommend that. I'm sorry. I have to tell this, or I wouldn't tell it. I know. I really didn't mean to, but I have to tell. I've really never told that in a pulpit. Everybody thinks I'm so sweet, but I was back in the day, I was not saved. That's to my defense, and I was very hateful. And but anyway, you know, you're supposed to go to the stop sign, Sister Janie, you're supposed to stop. I deliberately would floor it at every stop sign, and pedestrians would be coming. And finally, the instructor came up, and he said, you're going to have to slow down. He said, and you know, when people go... I'm trying to get through this. When people go across the street, you know you're supposed to stop. I said, oh, okay. I didn't tell him I was doing it on purpose because I'm pretty sure I'd have got kicked out of the class. But I said all that to say this. Somebody else was paying for my instructions. So therefore, I didn't care. Brother Tommy, I goofed off. I made it through. I don't know how in the world that driver's ed teacher ever survived me behind the wheel because it was a dangerous situation. I remember you say, well, wasn't you raised up in the days when you farmed? Yes, I was. They let me drive the tractor one time. Well, it wasn't my fault. My stepdad said, I said, well, what do I do? He said, just throw it in gear and go. He forgot to mention the clutch. And so I just throw it in gear, throwed him off the wagon, just kept on going. You know, just they didn't let me drive after that. She gave me better instructions. I needed it. But in that time, I didn't know how much I was going to need to have my operator's license. And it's easy to take it easy when somebody else is paying the bill. It's easy to goof off when somebody else is paying the price so that you get to have your time behind the wheel. But all that I did right there, Brother Tommy, when it came time for me to really get my driver's license, all that he had instructed me with and all that I goofed off into class with, it really didn't help me any. And I had to get out there and learn on my own really how to drive. And when it came time to pass my test, I had to do some hard studying. I had to get my cousins to let me borrow their car and teach me how to back up and teach me how to do something that I could already been taught because the price was already paid so that I could have it. But instead, I had to go and do it the hard way because I needed my operator's license. And God spoke to me and he said, I don't want an unlicensed church trying to operate in the spirit because we're going to have to get in there and pay the price to get the license and learn how to operate in the spirit. And I tell you what, the time for goofing off, we've had that time. It's over. We're in a serious time. We've got to learn how to get behind the wheel and get a hold of the things of God and let God take us where he wants to take us, and we're going to have to grow up and mature and learn how to operate in the spirit. I don't seem to go with the service tonight, but I came with what I came with. So anyway, sis, I had to learn the hard way how to drive, and I remember my cousins laughing at me because I can't back straight. To this day, I still cannot back straight. When it came time to do what they called a maneuverability, it used to be parallel parking. I can't do that either. And the one to do a maneuverability test, you know, when it came down for my time and I was in the seat and I was taking my driver's license test, I closed my eyes, and somehow I got in there. It's just, I mean, I did. He's just like, I just back right in there. I'm thinking, oh, yeah, that's going to happen. And so I just like halfway through, and I looked. And I was like, I'm going to run over all the cones. I closed my eyes. And, well, guess what? I did perfect. Got 100 on it. Don't recommend that ever. But in the skill of getting your operator's license, in learning how to drive, there has to be some steps that we got to go through. Number one, we need some instruction. You are blessed to be in a church that believes in teaching you under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. I'm glad that we're not here tonight. There's nothing wrong with education. It's good. It can add to everything. But without the anointing, it is just man's wisdom, and it is nothing. And we're talking about operating in the Spirit. We're not talking about operating in our knowledge or operating in our feelings, because our feelings are deceiving, and our knowledge is far below what God has. And we're talking about operating in the Spirit. So, you know, I had to learn the hard way how to do that, and then there was a test. And I wish that I'd paid attention when I'd been in there running over them pedestrians, really, you know, or doing all that and just being goofy, Tom, because I didn't realize how many times in life that I was going to need to have my operator's license. How many times in the middle of the night somebody was going to call and I was going to have to go? And it might be me and just me that gets behind the wheel other than God with me. And Freddie, I couldn't count on somebody else to pack me everywhere that I need to go. I needed to learn how to drive for myself. And God is raising him up a people that's going to learn how to operate in the Spirit for themselves by the grace of God between you and the Lord. He wants to get us to a mature level to where in the middle of the night somebody can call us and we can get in the Holy Ghost vehicle and go where he wants us to go. But it took some testing. And I had to learn how to read the signs. The Bible says to try the spirits and see whether they be of God or not. Everybody's got a move of the Spirit in different ways, and we know that God is truly on the move. And in these last days and in this hard time, Brother Tommy, I'm with you. We've had services that it just blows my mind what God's doing down at the little church. It could be 10 of us, it could be 7 of us, it could be 20, it doesn't matter. And God's in there doing stuff, and we are amazed by his presence and his power. But you get an unlicensed driver that's not trained, and they take over that, and they begin to get in the way of the Holy Ghost, you're going to have a train wreck on your hands before you know. Say, oh, that's rough preaching. No, it's true. It's just true. But guess what? Every one of us is allowed to get our operator's license. We live under a God that wants his church to grow and mature and be operating in the Spirit. He wants every one of us to go through those tests and learn how to operate in the Spirit. And say, well, if you're so good at it, have you always done it? No, I haven't. I'm not always the best driver either. I've had a few crashes along the way. And I will admit that the speed limit to me is an optional thing. I mean, I do go like, oh, do I feel like going 55 today? No, I really don't. I try to be reasonable, Brother Tommy. And I'm just going with this because it fits the message. I do admit that out on Bethany Ridge, Randall's Run, and Cedar Mills, there's 3 stop signs in a row. I pick which one I want to stop at. That gets on my nerves. There's 3. I mean, what in the world? Who thought that up anyhow? So we had a preacher in down to church, and he come to me, and he said, and he was using the stop sign as the example, and he picked me of all people. He said, you know, when you come to a stop sign, you stop, don't you? I'm in the house of God, and I have to tell the truth. And I'd tell the truth anyway, but I mean, they're all looking at me like, I said, well, if I feel like it, didn't go with the message. He said, if you feel like it? I thought, well, you don't drive where I drive, buddy. If you seen all them stop signs within 50 feet of one another, you'd pick one of them too. You just wouldn't stop. And in the middle of the night, when I'm coming home from church and it's going on 10, 11, 12 o'clock at night, I'm not stopping at any of them. Let me tell you, I hope there's no highway patrol in here tonight. But I just keep on going. He's not here. I'm good. Okay. Don't let him see this. He'll be out there 11 o'clock at night waiting at those three stop signs. I'm just teasing. But I can do that in the natural. I can choose, Brother Freddie, whether I want to go 55 or 60, sometimes 65. My car's got a nice engine in it. I don't like to drive a sewing machine. I really don't want to roller skate. I mean, I want something that's got some power. I want something that's got, like, back in the day it used to be a V8, but you can't really get them big old engines anymore as much as you could, but you can still get them with all the power registered for about 140, 150. No, I don't use all that. I can't see good enough to go that fast, and I can't think good enough to go that fast, but I like knowing the power's there if I need it. So in the natural, I get to choose. But let me tell you what, we do not get to choose in the spiritual. We don't get to pick which rule we want to follow. We don't get to pick which thing we get to do. We don't get to pick our calling. We don't get to pick our anointing. We don't get to pick anything. We have got to be totally surrendered to the Lord and let God give us our operator's license. He wants to raise us up. Church, we're in this day for a reason. I heard somebody say God could have saved Daniel and brought him for this time, or Jeremiah and brought him for this time. But here we are. And I'll be honest with you, without the instructions, I don't know what I'm doing. But when you get your instructions, it's different than following Google Maps. Have you ever followed all them Google Maps? We went somewhere one night and it could not get us there. No matter how hard it tried, and we followed it to the best of our ability, and this is the truth, if ever I told it, we got so far and we was pretty close to where we needed to be, and the woman says, walk the rest of the way. I said, that's rude. What do you mean walk the rest of the way? You're the instructor. I mean, we're just out there. Dale's like, well, where is it? I don't know. She said, walk the rest of the way. I mean, I'd never heard that before. One night, me and Karen got lost in, of all places, up there in Sodaville trying to get in or out. I can't remember. And it's dark, and I can't see good. And finally, the lady says, I can't help you anymore. I don't know if you've ever had those problems or not. Maybe it's just me, because I do wear her out. But you can't count on her. You cannot count on all that. But when you get your instructions from God, Brother Tommy, you can count on that. And you have to take them whether it's instructions you like or you don't. I tell you what, not everybody that operates in the Spirit is really joyful about what God has called them to do. Say there's joy in it. Yes, there is. But if you would have got to pick, if you would pick, that's the problem. We're picking what church we want to go to, which that's, you know, that's different than what church we need to be at sometimes. Don't get me wrong. Because if I got to pick what I wanted to, maybe I'd pick something different, but not right now the way my heart is concerning the little church up home. Because God does something in your heart that goes with your instructions. I thought how the brother said he was so glad God put him down here. I can relate to that. I was in a hard spot when God put me here years ago. I was in a place where I didn't even know left from right, sissy. I didn't know. I had an outside ministry. I had a singing ministry. I had an outside preaching ministry, but I didn't have no home. And I just would go visit places. And you can't live like an orphan forever. You got to have a home. So God settled me in down at Beach Fork here. And they loved on me and accepted me just the way I am. I don't know why, but they do. And sis, I tell you what, I grew here. And I learned to listen. And I learned to be instructed. I'd get back here in those Sunday school classes. And I every Sunday morning, I used to be like, well, it's Sunday school. You know, we got to go to Sunday school. But every Sunday morning, I was like, man, I get to go to Sunday school. Because there was somebody back there that had their operator's license that knew how to take me where I needed to be taken in the Word and teach me what I needed to be taught. And we had Brother Mark Bear and Brian Bear. I got to be in Burnett's class. If you've never been in, let me tell you, you're going to be blessed if you do. Because I went in there one morning and I'm thinking, I'm going to learn a lesson. She's under the anointing, whips out the oil, and we start praying. over every, oh man, what a morning we had back in that Sunday school room. Why? Because she's a licensed driver. You know, you feel safer when there's a licensed driver in control, I know, don't you? But I'd say she's went through some tests to get it. And the tests are not always easy. And still go through them. Because the thing is this, see, I got mine renewed this year. And you had to have, I don't know how many forms of identification. It's really a pain. For one thing, you're already going somewhere where they're going to ask you how old you are and how much you weigh. How rude do people have to be? Then they want proof of where you live, proof that you were born while you're standing there, you know. Then they want your social security number. And sissy, then they want to take a mugshot of you that looks like you just escaped from the prison and tell you to pack that in your wallet and show it to people. If you ask me, there's something rigged about the whole thing. But it's also very humbling. So she said to me, Julie, do you still live at so-and-so? And I said, yeah, we're still there. She said, well, I assume nothing else has changed. I'm looking at me, I'm looking at her, and I'm thinking, she's assumed. That's good enough for me. You just assume all you want to, honey. Just assume it. I just let her assume, Tom. I didn't lie. I didn't tell her anything. I didn't tell her about any extra pounds I might have packed on, you know, since the 4 years passed or nothing like that. She said, well, I assume everything's still the same. I said, I didn't answer. I just got out of that one. But when we are earning that license and getting it renewed in the Holy Ghost, we're going to be humbled. He's going to humble us down. Brother Freddie, many a times, God don't assume because God knows. He knows all about that face, what's behind there. He knows all about this body. He knows what's behind there. He knows where we live, and I'm not talking about in the natural. He knows where we live. He knows where we're living right now. And he knows how to get us to that place where we're willing to get those licenses renewed because we've got some more journeying to do. Church, our journey's not over. We got more driving to do. We've got a trip we still got to take, and we've got to make it in the Spirit. So anyway, went through all that, and guess what? Now it says that I am licensed to fly out of the country. I was already licensed to fly out of the country. I'm glad to be licensed to fly out of the country. I'm not talking about this country. I'm talking about going to heaven. I'm glad for the blood of Jesus that makes us ready to go to heaven. But there was another thing I had to do. She said, do you need your glasses to see? And I said, well, I didn't the last time. She said, well, we'll try it without your glasses. And you just tell me when you see the little light on the left and the light on the right. And, you know, read the little lines as far as you can. She didn't know I was squinting and making up some of those letters, but I made it. But she tested my vision. So I could keep my driver's license, my operator's license. We are living in a time where God is testing our vision. We are. We're living in a time, Brother Tommy, where God is testing our vision. If we can see him move on the left, if we can see him move on the right, if we can hear and see when he wants us to turn, or when he wants us to turn this way, or when it's just straight ahead. We are living in a time where God is testing our vision. Because, you know, we had a season where everybody was high on the mountain except for their hardships in life. But now the whole world is in a place. The whole church is in a place that we've never been before. But we're in this place where God is testing our vision. And I tell you what the devil wants to do. He wants to shut the doors, lock the doors, and keep them locked, and keep everybody home scared to death of something they cannot see when we should be scared of the one and reverence the one that we can feel but we can't see. We should have more fear for God than we do anything that's ever been placed on the face of the earth. We're going to lay these bodies down where nobody's getting out of here alive. Whether you go by the grave or you go by the rapture, guess what? You don't get to keep this body. We're out. Then I thought about how it is, and I will try not to hold you too long, but I've got to preach it out. When I preach it out, and God says I'm done, I'm done. Brother Freddie, I thought how hard it is to sit back and ride with somebody else. I am a control freak. I guess you probably didn't know that. I like to have control of how fast they go, when they slow down. I love to run the air conditioner. I think all the buttons in the car should be mine. As a matter of fact, when I ride with my husband and my sister, they call me the queen. And that's the truth. I didn't make that up. Say, are you awful? Yeah, probably. Do I care? No. It works. But when I'm in that car, Brother Tommy, it seems to me like that every time that they go too fast to get over, it's on my side. And I feel like I'm the one that's going to go in the ditch. And they're just happy as clams sitting there under the wheel, you know, just talking and driving. Hey, you're getting too close over here. Oh, I know what I'm doing. I said, well, obviously not. You know, that's just in the natural. But it is scarier to let someone else and let them have their time to operate in the spirit the way that God wants them to. And I'm just going to get through this as quick as I know how. There are different kind of drivers in the natural, the same as there are in the spiritual. Me, I'm a country driver. I like back roads. I like old haulers. I don't care about potholes. My husband will say, you hit that pothole. I said, listen, if this car can't stand this pothole, get rid of it. It's made to drive. He said, well, you ought to slow down for it. I said, why? Brother Ralph, we have this discussion quite often. He said, well, you hit that full force. I said, well, yeah. I mean, it's there. He's like, there's a squirrel. I said, squirrel's going to die. I know you guys are going to think I'm evil. I mean, they run. I mean, come on now. You know, I'm not dying over a squirrel. I'm sorry. I'm not. I'm not leaving the road. I'm not going to the ditch. I mean, if the little furry critter is out there, it's a tree rat anyhow. If it's out there in the middle of the road, I am not going to die over that. Oh, you say, well, what about deer? Well, I try because they're big. But I'm unlike the sissy. They ate all my tomatoes a couple years ago, so I have a grudge against them. I don't care sorry. I know they're cute. We'll leave it there. I don't want to sound too horrible. But I'm just saying, I'm a country driver. Brother Tom, I can get you on the back roads. I can take you to the shortcut, and I know which way to go in the country. But we had some friends, and one of them's done one on to heaven, and they were city drivers. And they moved to the country, and we used to ride with them. Man, had you best be prayed up and ready to go. Because you see, they were so used to driving in the city that when you got in, the first thing you did, you didn't even hesitate. You put that seatbelt on. Because they had two speeds, fast and stop. And so we'd go driving down a highway. I mean, you talk about me and driver's ed. Listen, some people do that in the real life, only they don't run over people, but you think they're going to. And they would just slam on that gas and get to the stop sign and slam on the brake. And let me tell you, it is annoying to ride with somebody that can't use a little bit of caution. You know, church, we can't be all go and no slow and no stop. We need to use some wisdom in the spirit. I tell you, I know folks that think just when they feel something, it's time to go and do something. You know what? It's time to pray about what God wants us to do. It's time to hear about what God wants us to do. I know I was going to preach like this. It's time to go with what God wants us to do, and I'm going to keep on driving because he's not done. And every time we get stirred up is not always the time for us to drive. So one night my mom was riding with her to church, and she'd rode with her to church. You'd had to know my mom. She, back then, I don't know that she was saved yet. It wouldn't have mattered. She'd have done this anyway. But anyway, Mom was riding with her, and I mean, we loved her. to no end. But she would get in, Mom, get in, and then she'd just pour the fire to it. She'd get to a stop sign, she'd just slam on the brake. So they're on their way to church, and it's a pretty far piece from the house. And Mom says, listen, you're going to have to stay on your side of the road and slow down. And she says, oh, I will. And she keeps on talking, and she's just driving like she's on the interstate. It's just nature to her. It was. She would drive like she was on the interstate, but she was on, you know, Blue Creek. You just don't do Blue Creek like you do 275. Let me tell you, you just can't. And you shouldn't. You really shouldn't. So anyway, she's just flying down through there, and Mom says to her, she said, I said, slow down. Oh, I will. I'm going to go slow just for you. She just kept pouring the fire to. About that time, Mom reached over and slapped her in the back of the head. Yeah, I'm a lot like her. And said, I said, slow down. Every time Mom rode with her after that, she was very cautious because Mom was going to lay one on her. God allow that to teach her to be more considerate of who is in the car. God will allow that for us too, to teach us to be more considerate about who's riding along with us. Not everybody likes to go the same speed. Now, I will admit, most people I have consideration over, but my sister rides with me sometimes, and I do try to scare her on purpose. But she's my sister, and she knows it's going to happen. Everybody else I try to have consideration for. It's a game between us, although if I see her claw the door and try to get out and moving, it kind of makes me happy. But anyway, you know, because she's my sister, and we just do that. But in the spiritual, even though I knew at that church the other night there was some just like, oh my goodness, I don't believe in going in somebody else's church and operating in the spirit the way I'm allowed to operate when God says it's time. But I can tell you this much. We had a situation come up and we needed to go to the city. Guess who we asked to take us? She knew exactly what she was doing in the right spot. We got to find the right spot. I'm telling you what, we went down there with her, and after that, I was like, hey, she might not can drive an old hauler, but man, you get her on 275, just turn her loose. You get me on 275, it's the end of the world probably, because I just don't do the interstate thing. But I like to boss everybody else that does. But God's got your spot. He's got where he wants to put you. We all have different vehicles we drive. We all have different spots that he wants to put us in. But right now, if ever there was a time that we needed some operator license being passed out, it's now. Brother Freddie, we don't know what's coming down the pike. We don't know. And you can't always count on someone else to take you where you need to go. We had a young lady that I worked with for a while, and I won't say her name or position in the family, but she's just like, you know, I don't want to drive because I dreamed that I got killed in a car wreck. Now, you know that I'm gracious and kind-hearted. And so I looked at her and I said, that's stupid. You can get killed in a car wreck when somebody else is driving too. You're going to get your license. She's like, well, I can't. I said, yes, you're going to. I'm going to help you, but you're going to. You got kids that are counting on you. You got a mother that might need you. I said, I won't be there all the time. Somebody else will not be there all the time. Somebody cannot come and take you in an emergency. They can't get to you fast enough. But if you have your operator's license, if you have your driver's license, guess what? You can get up and you can go when you have to go. It's always good to have company. I love it when we can all go together. But in the middle of the night, Brother Tommy, sometimes it's just not that way. When they called and my daughter was having her last baby, and I knew I wanted to be with my baby girl. And let me tell you, I did not drive legal that night because I live in Blue Creek and she was at Hillsborough Hospital. Within 45 minutes, I was in the parking lot and I was in that hospital where my baby was. Just in time, but God kept me safe because it's 2:00 in the morning and there was nobody on the road. And Hey, I see good if it's lights, you know, and I just took whatever part of the road I wanted. But you can't do that in the spiritual. But you in the natural, you know, that was all good. But nobody else was going to get me where I needed to go that night. I had to know the way. And I had to know that there was some power under the hood. And I had to know how to operate with that power. I used to have a 4-cylinder. It's a little 5-speed. Got it because it was cute. Thing run like a sewing machine. He's always shifting gears. You couldn't keep it steady. I'd get out there on 125 Hill and, you know, and it hit 40 and be like, say what? You know, want me to go up the hill? I said, you know, so I'm driving this little thing and something tore up on it. And I would like to tell you I was sad about that because we couldn't fix it, but I wasn't. I said, listen, give me something with some power. I'm not driving that thing anymore. He says, like, well, what do you want, a V8? I said, well, yeah, if we can get one sometime, and give me something with some power. But each car is different. But all of them have a source of power. All of them have a certain size engine. All of them, they can be electric, they can be diesel, they can be flex fuel, they can be gas, but they all have to have some sort of fuel, and they all have to have some kind of fire, and they all have to have some power under the hood, but they all, except for these cars that drive themselves, have to have an operator. But guess what? They got an operator too, but it's somebody that doesn't care a thing about you. It's just a robot, just a computer. Cares nothing about whether you live or whether you die. A lot of people are trusting their souls to somebody that cares nothing about them. As a matter of fact, he wants them dead. He wants to have the control and take them anywhere they want to go. But God wants a people that know how to operate in the spirit, get a hold of something that's got some fuel, some power, and some fire, and get in there and go. But guess what? You still got to go to the gas station, fuel station, electric place, wherever. Personally, here in Blue Creek or where I live, I don't think an electric car is going to ever be my option. I mean, I have an electric bill. That's enough right there. And a generator. And you better have. And you better have probably more than one the way it's looking. But we cannot count on anyone but him. We can count on each other. I know that. But there are times it's going to be just you and him. And you got to be able to know that you can operate. Brother Tommy won't always be there. Brother Tommy, I'm sure all those years of instruction down here, you wasn't sure where God was taking you. And you probably wasn't ready for this. And I wasn't ready for it up home either. I was just like, what, Lord, that was somebody else. No, it's not. It's not always somebody else. Sometimes it's you. I'll say this, and I think I'll close. You still have to pay the price for the fuel. I took my classes really serious after that when I was the one paying the price. You still have to put gas in the tank, diesel, whatever it may be. Still have to keep that engine in good running order. It's nice to have an operator's license, but if you don't have any power to take you where you need to go, you just got a picture to look at. God's got a different kind of a church, and he wants to raise it up in this different situation. Saying it's the same? It's the same, but it's a different time. And he's raising us up, and it's time. I'm going to turn it over to Brother Tommy.